Did you have a hard time following Hathaway's Flash? Maybe you are new to the Gundam franchise, or you haven't watched Gundam in a while. No need to worry. I'm going to break down all the major events from the One-Year War all the way to MAFTY. So let's start at the beginning, with the rise of the Earth Federation and the formation of Zeon. The Earth Federation was conceived by the elite ruling class in the late 21st century. The Earth Federation was formed due to diminishing resources, overpopulation, famines, and wars over living spaces. In order to combat this, the Earth Federation announced the colonization plan. The Earth Federation would create orbiting space habitats known as space colonies. This would begin the Universal Century timeline. These space colonies would be placed at 5 gravitationally stable points. A group of colonies that occupy these points are collectively known as a side. Side 3 is really where this story begins. Side 3 is located behind the moon and at the time was known as Munzo. Now fast forward to UC-52. Zeon Zoom Daikun along with his wife, son Kazval and daughter Articia moved to Side 3 and began spreading his philosophy of Kantalism, which is essentially the Earth was sacred and that human beings had the solemn right to protect it. He also taught New Type Theory, which was a belief space noise would need to evolve to be able to live in outer space and acquire almost like a sixth sense. His message would spread through the space colonies that made up Side 3, and they would eventually appoint him the Prime Minister and leader of Side 3. He would create a republic and announce their independence, and rename Side 3 the Republic of Zeon. The Earth Federation did not take kindly to this and responded with sanctions, essentially halting all resources to the colonies. Daikun responded by creating a colonial guard in case the Earth Federation wanted to invade and stop their push for independence. Soon after, Zeon suddenly died, and his close friend and advisor, Degwin Zabi, claimed Zeon named him his successor on his deathbed. Now, many people believed that Zeon was assassinated, but no concrete evidence ever surfaced. Zabi would change the Republic of Zeon to the Principality of Zeon, appointing himself as sovereign and placing his children in high-ranking roles. During this time, Zabi would begin purging the colonies of Zeon Daikun loyalists, including his son and daughter. His kids would escape thanks to the help of a family friend. Now his son Kazval would take a very important identity at this time, and he would be known as Char Aznable. Now during this time there would be a breakthrough with technology on Side 3 with the Monofsky Particles. This brought many other technological advances and finally helped mobile suits be ready for mass production. With negotiations breaking down, the Principality of Zeon officially declared war against the Earth Federation in UC-0079, and this began the infamous One-Year War. Now, the first important battle that took place during the One-Year War would be the One-Week Battle. The One-Week Battle was launched against Side 1, 2, and 4, merely seconds after Zeon declared war. Now, Zeon's goal for this battle would be to defeat the Earth Federation forces and use a depopulated space colony of Side 2 and drop it to the Earth in hopes of destroying the Earth Federation's main headquarters located in Jaburo. This plan did not work because the colony broke up upon entering the Earth's atmosphere. Now, the next important battle that would take place would be the Battle of Loom. Zeon forces would attack Side 5 known as Loom, attempting a second colony drop to Earth. I guess if at first you don't succeed, try again, right? This attempt would turn into a full-scale battle when the Earth Federation forces counterattacked using nuclear weapons. This did not stop Zeon's attempt at dropping the colony, but costed many lives on both sides. This battle was also the first battle to showcase the true potential of mobile suits, and also cemented the legacy of a certain Zeon pilot named Char Aznable. Now, with two attempts at dropping space colonies and the Earth Federation using nukes, a third of humanity's population is now dead, and the Earth Federation and Zeon said, hey, we need to lay some ground rules here, and this led to the Antarctic Treaty. Zeon originally was hoping for the Earth Federation to surrender, but they refused. Instead, they negotiated several agreements, like no use of nuclear and chemical weapons, also colony drops were forbidden. With colony drops forbidden, Zeon went with an invasion of the Earth, in hopes of capturing the Earth Federation's headquarters. It is at this point that the Earth Federation finished with Operation V, which was the creation of their own mobile suits, the gun tank, gun cannon, and of course the RX-78-2 Gundam. This is when we see Amuro take the RX-78 and become the official pilot, approved by Bright Noah. It is also at this point that we follow Bright Noah, Amuro Ray, and the others of the White Base through the war in Gundam 0079. We follow them through great battles with Char, and all pivotal battles against Zeon. The war finally started declining during Operation Star 1, When Zeon leader Degwin Zabi reached out to the Earth Federation leaders with hopes of negotiating an end to the war. His own son would not allow this to happen and killed his own father along with the Earth Federation leaders with the Solar Ray Cannon. This one action would unravel Zeon to its core. After the death of Degwin, his daughter Khaleesia would kill her brother for murdering their father, and she would meet her fate shortly after this by Char, who would finally get revenge for the murder of his family. With the death of the leadership on both sides, the newly restored Republic of Zeon surrendered to the Earth Federation and signed the Granada Peace Treaty on January 1st, UC 80, officially ending the one-year war. Now let's talk about the aftermath. Now after the war, Zeon was able to keep their independence, but some remaining soldiers were upset with the conclusion of the war and fled to Zeon Axis, located in the asteroid belt. Some did stay on Earth and the colonies with hopes of one day striking back at them. With the complete destruction of sides 1, 2, 4, and 5, this left the majority of the population concentrated on the Earth, Moon, sides 3 and 6. The hostility between Earthnoids and Spacenoids remain, and the one-year war has caused a kind of racial divide where Earthnoids consider themselves to be the elite class. Rogue former Zeon militants would channel this hostility and in UC-83 launch Operation Stardust, in which former Zeon soldiers would attempt to expose the Earth Federation's corruptness and cut off their food supply by dropping another colony to Earth, aimed at the North American continent. This colony drop would be successful and give rise to the Titans. The Titans were created as a counterinsurgency group formed by the Earth Federation in response to Operation Stardust. The Titans served one purpose, to hunt down renegade citizens who either supported Zeon or spoke out against the Federation government. Now, the Titans will continue their mission unchallenged for about 4 years, and became more and more ruthless, taking part in atrocities just to carry out their missions. But how could our hero Amuro allow this? Or how about Bright Noah? At this time, Amuro was placed under house arrest as the Earth Federation did not trust new types. And don't worry, if house arrest is being confined to a giant mansion, sign me up. We do, however, see someone push back. The Anti-Earth Union Group, or AUG for short. This will lead us into the events of the Gripes conflict. This conflict officially started on March 2nd, UC 87, when a small squad led by Char was dispatched to infiltrate the two Titan colonies on Side 7. Char discovered that the new Mark II Gundam was being used to train Titan pilots on Gripes. Upon this discovery, the team decided to steal the new Gundam. They received unexpected help from a boy named Camille Biden. The Titan's commander-in-chief reacted very quickly and took Camille's parents as hostages. Camille did try to rescue his parents, but both were killed in the battle. After the successful heist, the Titans announced to the world that this was an act of terror and committed by the AUG, and the Titans began pursuit. The AUG tried to escape from Side 7 to the moon in preparation for a large-scale assault on Jaburo. It is at this time the famous captain of the White Base, Bright Noah, joined the AUG. After some rest on the moon, on May 11th, the AUG commenced their attack on Jaburo. The AUG did make it through the atmosphere, but soon realized that the Titans had abandoned their base at Jaburo and that this was a trap. The Titans set off a nuclear bomb, but luckily the AUG escaped. This was a major loss to the AUG because they were unable to reduce the Titans' strength, and some of their best pilots were now stranded on the Earth. While stuck on the Earth, Camille finally takes control of the new advanced Zeta Gundam. Also during this time, we see Amuro join the fight, as well as the Axis Zeon planning to join the fight. The Republic of Zeon decided to join the Titan side, and gave them their fortress at Abaku. On August 17th, the founder of AUG was assassinated, and Char became the new leader of the AUG. Through the next months, the Titans started attacking the colonies and moon cities, breaking the rules of the Arctic Treaty, like trying to drop a colony on the lunar city of Granada, and attacking Colony 25 on Side 2 with poisonous gas. Now, after a 20-month journey, Axis Zeon finally made it to the Earth Sphere. Because the Axis Zeon was made up of a lot of former Principality of Zeon members, both the AUG and the Titans wanted to ally themselves with them, because of their great military strength. Char was given the first audience with Degwin Zabi's youngest daughter, Mineva. Char realized that Mineva was nothing more than a puppet for Haman, who was the true leader of Axis Zeon. When he confronted her about this, he destroyed any chance of an alliance, and Axis allied itself with the Titans the following day. Now on November 16th, Char revealed his true identity as Char and denounced the Titans in front of the whole world. His message was strengthened due to the fact that the Titans were fighting above the city with no regard to civilians or delegates. The fight was also being broadcast to the world, and the Titans were unable to dismiss any claims against them. With public opinion now against the Titans were looking to reestablish themselves as a force to be feared. The Titans developed plans to attack space colonies, and their worst decision was to attack Anaheim Electronics headquarters on the moon. If you don't know what Anaheim Electronics is, they are the major manufacturers of mobile suits and other important tech. Anaheim Electronics was providing the AUG with mobile suits and other resources. That is why the Titans targeted their moon facility. The sponsors of the AUG made a deal with Axis Zeon. If they would destroy the colony laser, they would give her Side 3, and the Principality of Zeon would live again. Haman, of course, agreed to this and captured the colony laser for themselves, and sent Axis on a collision course to the moon city of Granada. Negotiations between Axis and the Titans broke down, with the Titans' leadership being killed. This allowed Sirocco to seize control of the Titans. The AUG launches an attack to take over the colony laser. They were able to succeed and win the battle to stop the Axis asteroid from crashing into the lunar city. The Titans, AUG, and Axis met for a final battle. The Titans were in firing range of the colony laser, and Bright Noah seized the opportunity to finally destroy the Titans. Axis pulled out of the battle to prepare for an Earth invasion. Sadly, the Titans were not destroyed before Sirocco was able to attack Camille with a mental attack, crippling his mind. Char was officially missing in action, but the AUG came out the victor of this long conflict, marking the end of this on February UC 88. With the Titans destroyed and the AUG forces being heavily depleted and their ace pilots missing or unfit for combat, the Axis Zeon launched their attack for control on March 3rd, UC 88, and with this action began the first Neo-Zeon War. A few weeks after Neo-Zeon landed its armed forces on Earth, they launched an attack on the Earth Federation's assembly on Dakar and seized it temporarily. However, the AUG launched a counterattack to retake the assembly, forcing Neo-Zeon to retreat. On October 31st, UC 88, Neo-Zeon planned a colony drop on Dublin, Ireland. The Earth Federation officials chose to remain silent on this, and even saying that it would be better losing civilian lives than government. Luckily, the AUG interfered and got civilians out. Now, believe it or not, the fall of Neo-Zeon would actually be by the hands of Neo-Zeon, in what is known as the Neo-Zeon Civil War. Now, Neo-Zeon had been ruled by Haman since the inception of Neo-Zeon, but at this time, Glemmy Toto decided to step forward and claim to be the true ruler of Neo-Zeon. The last remaining child of Degwin Zabi has been missing since the defeat of the Titans. So with no clear ruler, two factions were created, and the Glemmy faction engaged in battle with the Haman faction. The Gundam team took advantage of this, and also engaged with both Zeon forces. Now, with no leadership at all, Neo-Zeon officially surrendered to the Earth Federation on January 1st, UC 89. The AUG disbanded and rejoined the Earth Federation, and some of the AUG became the new elite counterinsurgency task force known as London Bell, which was commanded by Bright Noah. Now, with fighting over a decade, you would think this would finally be over, right? But sadly, nope. There was a bit of peace. There was a bit of peace, but little did anyone know that some of the remnants of Haman's Neo-Zeon would be secretly joining Char. That's right, the Red Comet is alive. In UC 93, Char and Neo-Zeon decided to drop an asteroid to Earth. During this, Char and Amuro met, and Amuro tries to explain that if the asteroid drops to Earth, it will cause a nuclear winter. Char replies that there will always be selfish people living on the Earth, and that it must be eradicated. Char eventually retreats from the battle, and the drop is unsuccessful. During this time, we are first introduced to Bright Noah's son, Hathaway Noah, and Amuro is first introduced to the Psycho Frame in the RX-93 New Gundam. Char decides he is not done, and they will drop the asteroid base Axis to Earth. Now, during the battle to stop this, Char and Amuro get into a high-emotion conversation, and all the will of the people trying to stop Axis activate the Psycho Frame, and this pushes the asteroid in the opposite direction. Sadly, at this point, Char and Amuro did not make it out of this conflict. Now, there was a third Neo-Zeon War led by Char's clone Full Frontal in UC 96. We won't go too deep into this because the Neo-Zeon fights get repetitive. But basically, after this battle, we see the Republic of Zeon give up its independence and rejoin the Earth Federation. After all that, right, they just rejoin. But this puts us to UC 105, where Hathaway's Flash takes place. So the Earth Federation has become more corrupt and they are destroying the Earth with increased pollution and overpopulation. They are also rounding up people and deporting them to space colonies against their wishes. So another anti-Earth Federation group is formed known as MAFTI and is led by MAFTI Navu Aaron, which is Hathaway Noah. MAFTI is assassinating high-profile politicians for revenge on how people have been treated. We see Hathaway on his way back from the moon where he was meeting with Anaheim Electronics to build the RX-105Z Gundam. We then see the ship he is on get attacked by MAFTI impersonators. Due to this, he is held by the Earth Federation officials for questioning. After an air raid, Hathaway boards a ship to intercept his Gundam, and after a battle with the Penelope, he rejoins the rest of his Mafti crew. And this is where Hathaway Flash ends. There will be two more installments in this story, so I hope this helped everyone who had questions, not just with Hathaway's Flash, but with the UC timeline altogether. I will make more videos like this, so let me know in the comments what Gundam topics you would like covered, and if you want to check out any of my other socials, I will have them linked in the description, as well as my Discord. Subscribe for more content.